Penguin Random House Audio presents 1774, The Long Year of Revolution, by Mary Beth Norton. Read for you by Kimberly Farr. For Martha Farnsworth, and to the memory of Mary Elizabeth Lunny Norton. Come, come, my brave boys, from my song you shall hear that will crown 74 a most glorious year. The New York Journal, August 18th, 1774. I almost wish to live to hear the triumphs of the Jubilee in the year 1874, to see the medals, pictures, fragments of writings, etc., that shall be displayed to revive the memory of the proceedings of the Congress in the year 1774. Dunlap's Pennsylvania Packet, November 14th, 1774. Introduction. The year 1774 dawned 16 days after the Boston Tea Party, and by the time its 12 months ended, the royal provincial governments were in disarray, the First Continental Congress had convened and adjourned, and the battles at Lexington and Concord were just 3.5 months in the future. That sentence opened the first chapter of my first book, published in 1972. My research on Loyalist exiles during the Revolution convinced me that events in 1774 were critical to the development of the movement for independence, and I have remained convinced of that conclusion ever since. This book is the belated result of that conviction. In 1774, the phenomenon known as loyalism first appeared, as did the term loyalist. The emergence of people who called themselves loyalists signaled an important change in the colonial political climate, for their presence implied the existence of the opposite phenomenon, people who were openly disloyal. Before 1774, most politically aware Americans were united in criticizing policies about colonial taxation and governance that Parliament adopted after the end of the Seven Years' War in 1763. Conservatives and radicals debated methods of resistance, but well into the 1770s, free colonists uniformly identified themselves as loyal subjects of King George III, and gloried in their membership in the British Empire. For revolution to occur, that identification as loyal Britons had to change. Some men and women had to start thinking differently about America's relationship with the empire, while others persisted in retaining their traditional loyalty to the crown. I have come to term the period of dramatic change the Long 1774. That is, the 16 months between December 1773 and mid-April 1775. The unprecedented events that occurred in the English colonies in North America during those months are the subject of this book. Almost all historians who study the Revolution as a whole have focused on the revolutionaries, the men who led resistance to Great Britain starting in the mid-1760s. For such scholars, developments in 1774 appear to be of a piece with previous occurrences. The Stamp Act riots of 1765, opposition to the Townshend Acts in 1767 to 1770, the Boston Massacre of 1770, the Gaspé incident of 1772, all seem to lead inexorably, if not almost inevitably, to the Revolutionary War that followed. When historians have concentrated on events preceding the outbreak of fighting, they have devoted considerably more attention to Massachusetts than to the rest of Eastern North America. Yet a focus on those who remained loyal to the empire points up the significance of events in 1774 throughout the colonies, not just in Massachusetts. The evolving tactics pursued by colonial opponents of British policies began to cause new divisions in popular opinion, everywhere leading to increasing political polarization. Still, almost all scholars who have studied the Loyalists have confined their attention specifically to that subject, rather than venturing to approach the wider topic of the Revolution as a whole from the perspective of their previous work on those loyal to the Crown. This book, by contrast, has been shaped by my long-standing interest in the Loyalists. Rather than viewing the months between December 1773 and April 1775 with the common implicit or explicit assumption that resistance leaders commanded a people largely unified around a radical agenda, it reveals the many debates, disagreements, and disruptions that characterized the period in all the colonies, from New Hampshire south to Georgia. Instead of privileging the viewpoints of men like Samuel Adams and focusing almost exclusively on his province of Massachusetts, it gives voice to such moderate colonists as Joseph Reed and John Dickinson of Pennsylvania, and details the disputes that roiled New York throughout the year. It pays attention to the opinions of colonial officials and others who sent regular reports to London about political circumstances in their colonies. It also analyzes the writings of the Loyalist pamphleteers, who first published their vehement dissents while the Continental Congress was in session in September, and examines how more radical authors responded to Loyalists' arguments. I aim, in short, to include the views of all of those who participated in formal political discourse in the colonies in 1774, regardless of their gender, race, or place of residence. I sought evidence in a variety of libraries, from the National Archives of the United Kingdom to the Huntington Library in San Marino, California, and many universities and state historical societies. The narrative has been constructed from the published and unpublished correspondence of political leaders and ordinary folk alike, from pamphlets and broadsides, from the official records of colonial governments and their revolutionary successors, and from newspapers with reports of local meetings and other activities, along with essays expressing a wide range of opinions. Because of the emphasis on formal political discourse, it devotes less attention to those who are often termed the people out of doors, although it does not exclude them entirely from consideration. As will be seen in the following pages, people who did not leave written records of their opinions nevertheless revealed their ideas through their actions. The book's basic narrative is perhaps deceptively familiar. It begins in October 1773, when seven ships carrying East India Company, EIC, tea, sailed from Great Britain to North America under the terms of the recently adopted Tea Act, which for the first time allowed the EIC to sell its tea directly to colonists. Five arrived in the ports of Boston, Charleston, and Philadelphia in December, while another wrecked on Cape Cod. The other vessel, blown far off course by an Atlantic gale, did not reach New York until April, after spending the winter in Antigua. In Charleston, customs officers seized and stored the tea. In Philadelphia and New York, the ships were not allowed to enter the harbor. And in Boston, famously, men crudely disguised as Indians destroyed the tea. Subsequently, colonists had to await Britain's reaction to the fate of the ships. News of that reaction first arrived in mid-May, with further details trickling in over the next few months. Americans learned that Parliament had closed the port of Boston until the tea was paid for. then followed up with a series of punitive laws known as the Coercive Acts. During the summer of 1774, Americans everywhere discussed the appropriate response to such parliamentary measures, leading to the convening of the First Continental Congress in September. Before
adjourning, we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.